Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I love that I got a good morning back over here. You are an amazing group of students and mentors. The energy in the room this morning, yesterday in the Villard room with our students at Alumni House last night with our mentors was just fantastic. So I want to begin by welcoming you all here this morning for our fourth annual Sophomore Career Connections. It's amazing. My name is Stacey Bingham. I'm the director of the Career Development Office here at Vassar. Students and mentors, we have an amazing weekend in store for you. Sophomore Career Connections is really designed to draw upon the expertise of one of Vassar's very best career resources, our alumni, parents, and friends of Vassar, and to help students complement their liberal arts education with some industry-specific knowledge, tap into that extensive Vassar network, and focus on your professional development in a safe space. We piloted this program in 2015 with 125 sophomores and 50 mentors, and this year we welcome our biggest group of students and mentors yet, with nearly 250 sophomores and nearly 80 mentors. Woo! So as you might imagine, planning a program like this in January, before campus is officially open, is a huge, huge endeavor that takes an enormous amount of collaboration, both between the Career Development Office and the Office of Alumni Affairs and Development, but also really the support of the entire campus. Facilities operations, residential life, communications, media resources, and of course, campus dining, and all of the countless individuals in between. Mentors, are you amazed by what you saw downstairs? Yeah. Yes, right? So I would also like to personally acknowledge two very important people who have given tremendous financial support to underwrite Sophomore Career Connections for 4 years running, Carol Ostrow and Michael Graff. And in just a moment, I'm going to turn the podium over to Vassar's own President Elizabeth Bradley to introduce our keynote speaker, Gloria Larson, class of 72. And Betsy has been an incredible champion of Sophomore Career Connections from the moment she heard about it, and I am just incredibly grateful for her support. Thank you.
Stacy, great job! You did it! I'm tremendously thankful to your leadership to be able to put something like this together in the sophomore year. I think it is the key moment where you sort of shift from, I'm in a new place, to, okay, what am I gonna do? Where, who am I? So, bravo. I also am so thankful to Carol and Michael. Wonderful, wonderful to have you at my house last night. Tonight we'll do the same, stay up late, have a few drinks. It wasn't really like that, but. Really appreciate learning the Vassar way from you, so thank you so much. Well, it's a tremendous honor for me to introduce our keynote speaker, Gloria Larson. She, as you know from her bio, has been the president of Bentley University for 11 years. And she, before that, was a highly successful lawyer in Boston. You might not know, she's also an author. And her book, Prepared You, is fabulous. You absolutely should get this book. She coins a phrase, hybrid education, which really integrates business thinking and what really Bentley was known for with what she learned at Vassar, the liberal arts. And how can these really be used together? No better champion for that integration, I think, in our country than Gloria Larson. She also has been launching centers that start to bring out where we have more limitations. For instance, she launched the Center for Women and Business at Bentley and is still, I believe, on the board, even after you will be done as the president, which this is her last year. She has thousands of extra sort of socially and community-based participation experience as well. She co-chaired the Government Strategies Group, She led the business advisory cabinet at the Massachusetts Democratic governor for the Democratic governor Deval Patrick, and she served as secretary of economic affairs under Massachusetts Republican governor William Weld. She has this huge breadth, from being a lawyer to a business person to a leader in a liberal arts, a university that strut forward with the liberal arts. All I can say is she is just the perfect illustration of what a Vassar degree can give you, and a tremendous role model for me, and I think will be for all of you. So Gloria, thank you so much for coming today. Please join me in welcoming her.
Bradley, I feel like my last year, my 11th year, I'm following in your footsteps too, and that may be partly due to the fact that I got to have a few drinks with Betsy and John last night as well, and that is the Vassar I remember. I am so glad to be back with all of you, and I look out at a group of sophomores, and you have so much in front of you, and at the same time, the next couple of years are just going to zip by, and it's such a wonderful period. I have to tell you, Vassar meant everything to me, and I'm going to talk just a little bit about that today. But the good news is I'm going to refer to some notes, but I'm not reading a speech. So I want to give you sort of a snapshot of what my career has been like. It has been completely nonlinear. I really didn't understand straight lines even in college, and so I've never had a plan. And I think at the end of this, I'm going to urge you not to have any sort of detailed career and life plan. Some of the mentors today may have a different opinion, but my view is the more you're open to change and opportunity, the more you know what you're passionate about and you continuously just do simply what you love, the better off you're going to be throughout. So as Betsy said, I graduated from Vassar in 1972. I could not have predicted in a million years, because I headed off to law school after that, that I would end up as the president of a business university, but here I am, and it's been the greatest honor of a very long 40-year career. And I say that in part because it was so unexpected. But when I look back on my early childhood, I realize that I had sort of a big vision about broadly what I wanted to do, vague as it might have been. So I thought I would start by giving you a little bit of the backstory. I'm an Air Force brat, and I was in 7 schools before I got to Vassar in 1968. And while this might have proved difficult for lots of kids, it wasn't for me, because my parents paved the way. They not only encouraged me to still care about my studies, which I did, but I got involved in lots of school activities and lots of community activities, because they believed wherever we lived should be home. So that was terrific, but it also involved weekly trips to the library with my mom when I was in grade school, and I became a voracious reader, something that's not uncommon for those of us who end up at Vassar. At age 8, I was given my first Nancy Drew book. That was critically important to me, and I have to tell you something. 3 Supreme Court justices, Oprah Winfrey and Hillary Clinton, all claimed Nancy Drew as their role model when they were growing up too. So I'm in pretty good company. So a lot has been written about Nancy. One writer said this: she showed a finely tuned sense of good and evil, the very model of the independent young woman on a mission. So I was 8 years old, and for me, she was a thinker and a doer. She wanted to make a difference in people's lives, and that's exactly, I didn't know what that meant, but that's exactly what I wanted to do, and exactly like Nancy, I wanted to be dressed in matching skirt and heels. So fast forward. Several years later, I drew a much deeper inspiration from Atticus Finch in To Kill a Mockingbird. Midway through the book, I was 12 years old, I knew I would be a lawyer. It's a complicated book, as you know, and we know even more now about the model, Harper Lee's dad, that it was based on. He was more complicated in the 1950s when she was growing up and writing than we knew. But at the time, the book, a book of fiction, shows open-mindedness, egalitarianism, caring about the kinds of justice that the law can bring if done correctly, but also that fighting for justice is a lot weightier than my idealistic view of what Nancy Drew was capable of had shown me earlier. So we all know that Tom Robinson, the black defendant who Atticus chooses to defend, is unfortunately and wrongly convicted by a racist jury in small town Alabama back in that era. But I was so inspired inspired by Atticus Finch's personal sense of justice, his personal sense of, I know idealism will only take you so far, you have to be grounded in realism too, and his very strong moral compass, that I knew I was headed for law school. So fast forward to Vassar. I'm going to give you a little snapshot about what life was like for me in 1968 when I arrived here. I arrived with a really cool bohemian bedspread, and a footlocker that was packed to the gills with all of my college-bound possessions. But more to the point, I came wondering, what's my future going to be like? What am I going to do post-law school? How am I going to take this interest in public policy and the law and make something out of it? And I didn't know. This was a time of tremendous social and political activism. I probably don't need to tell you that. We all arrived with strike armbands when we came to Vassar. And it was an important time for our country. It wasn't just on college campuses. And I think it bears a lot of familiarity for those of us who are trying to translate what's happening in our own world and country today. The anti-war movement, the women's movement, and the civil rights movement were all calling for major change in our country. Following my high school graduation in June of 1968, I had gone to National Solidarity Day in Washington. 50,000 people gathered in the wake of Martin Luther King's assassination that prior April, my senior year in high school. We listened to his wife, Coretta King, say at that gathering, "Love is the only force that can destroy hate." And at the same time, 3 days later, I got a letter from Vassar College. Not my admissions letter, I'd already gotten that, but it was a letter saying, would you like to participate in a summer reading program about social justice and about race and society? And it was purely voluntary, but I had just been to National Solidarity Day, and so I signed up and got the chance to read things like Malcolm X and Black Like Me, and it culminated in a joint Vassar-Yale retreat a week or two before school actually started here in Poughkeepsie. It was an amazing opportunity to share views with a group of kids who were similarly minded, and it really deepened my interest in thinking hard about who am I? What's the world going to be like? What's going to be my role in trying to make a difference? Vassar had almost no core requirements. In fact, I think we had no core requirements when I came. It was an era where you really got to choose anything, and I did. I took a smattering of everything across every different department, but ultimately I zeroed in on sociology, political science, and philosophy, thinking that these were things that genuinely represented my interests, but also knowing that these were things that would allow me to start thinking about public interest, and I was developing an interest in urban policy. It was a time of change in cities. Lots was going on in poor urban areas. And so I also spent, and this will be very familiar to you, only parts of this, but I spent about 8 bazillion all-nighters while I was at Vassar. At least 3 of those were studying. Most of those were all about talking about the issues, burning issues of our time with so many great peers across the college campus. Some of it was fueled by a few drinks at a place called The Dutch, where we all hung out. Some of the mentors may know what I'm talking about, and I'm going to admit to you right now that occasionally, these discussions were also fueled by a certain recreational drug that's now legal in 8 states and the District of Columbia. This was the late 60s, okay? So a couple of years later, I graduated from University of Virginia Law School, a radically different experience. Only 22% of my class was women. I was pleased to be the president of the Virginia Law Women, hearty band that we were. And I also did a lot of legal aid work in environmental issues and also defending institutionalized mental health patients. This was an amazing opportunity to think even more deeply. What do I really want to do? I'd say about 90% of my classmates went either in-house as corporate counsel or to very big law firms and partnerships ultimately, but what I wanted to do was something in the public interest, and I grabbed an amazing job setting up a legal program statewide in Virginia for the elderly. It was a once-in-a-lifetime chance right out of law school to do something that not only honed my legal skills, but gave me a chance to do something that I felt really might make a difference. From that, I grew this real interest in consumer protection issues, and I went to the Federal Trade Commission in Washington, where I spent almost a decade working on both consumer protection and antitrust cases. And for me, the reason this was important was I deepened my legal skills, I became a good litigator, but more to the point, I developed a personal philosophy about the regulatory landscape. What should you do to make sure that companies really behave in a fair way? How do you bring them to the table? How do you weed out to do the right thing? And how do you weed out the bad apples? So it was a formative experience, but the most formative thing that happened to me was that I got plucked out of oblivion as one of the staff attorneys to work for one of the five Federal Trade Commissioners. These are presidentially appointed folks on the FTC Commission, and I went to work for the only woman. This was 35 years ago, and I got the chance to get up every single day and go to work for a woman who'd already broken through the glass ceiling, who had a strong social justice and public interest bent just like I did, and she was a phenomenal role model and mentor to me. I could not have asked for more, including the fact that every Friday afternoon she felt that we should do a major debrief on what had happened that week, and we always did it over a bottle of wine. You may detect a pattern in some of what I'm telling you. So my career would absolutely have continued in Washington. I was completely smitten, although I'm sure by now I might have departed Washington. But for a really interesting quirk of fate, I had met a guy who was an antitrust lawyer, and he moved, my boyfriend moved to Massachusetts to practice law. And I also was friends with a senior Justice Department lawyer named Bill Weld, who would a few years later become governor of Massachusetts. I had been keeping Eastern Airlines alive for at least two extra years. I flew for 7 years every weekend between Washington and Boston when finally Governor Weld was elected and he invited me to join his cabinet as Secretary of Business Affairs and Regulatory Practice and Consumer Protection. So, and he said, by the way, you will live in the same state as your by now husband, Alan Larson. So it was a good thing. It had been crazy, it had been chaotic, and I was thrilled. This was an amazing rubber meets the road chance to really understand what I'd been doing at a national level and really think even harder about economic development. What can you do to our school systems, our K through 12 system? What can you do to aging infrastructure? What can you do when you're trying to spawn the right kind of job growth to actually build jobs that are available to everyone? It was a wonderful, critical moment for me to put together what had been about 12 years of prior experience thinking, you know, at a really high national level. 15 years into my federal and state roles, I decided that I was going to go into private practice. And the reason I went into private practice was someone who was my hero, the late Paul Tsongas, who had been a much admired senator in Massachusetts who ran for the presidency, a progressive Democrat, and he was practicing law at Foley Hoag. And I thought, oh my God, this is a chance to work on government policy, on regulatory policy, and to do it from the other side in terms of a perspective. We were still representing government agencies and nonprofits, but it gave me a chance to get sort of a different worldview, and they had a great reputation for pro bono work. So equally important, remember, I'm an Air Force kid. Even though my parents worked hard to integrate us into different communities, Boston is the first place I lived that I consider, and to this day, consider my permanent home. So I got very involved in civic and community work. I got to be in charge of building a huge convention center, creating a series of urban parks where our old elevated highway used to be in Boston. I got the chance, as Betsy so kindly mentioned, to chair the transition team for Governor Deval Patrick, who I still hold out as a potential presidential candidate one of these days. An amazing, amazing person. So, and I got the chance to start what is now 13 years old, which is the Massachusetts Conference for Women. Every year we welcome 12,000 women to a conference that is now the largest in the country. And this year, our keynote speakers were just incredible and included Meryl Streep, Vassar grad the year before me, class of 71, interviewed by Gloria Steinem for an hour on stage. Think of that in terms of the movements, the Me Too movement and all that's going on in our country. And it is just, you know, it was an amazing amazing experience. So imagine, after 10 years at Foley Hoag, how I felt when I was approached completely unexpectedly by the Board of Trustees at Bentley, then college, now university. And they said, would you consider throwing your hat in the ring? And I was at a dinner party, and I remember pouring another glass of wine, thinking, this is crazy. Why would, and then I went home and I said to my husband, please don't tell anyone at Bentley I ever said this, but a week later I said to my husband, you know, I think I'm gonna do this, but remind me, was it Bentley or Babson they're talking about? My orientation was law and public policy, not a B school, but what grabbed me about the idea when I realized that, of course, that it was Bentley, is that this was a chance to take what I'd been thinking about for my entire career. How do you make a real difference? How do you bring an idea about the public interest to bear in a B school, where these kids are going to go into the organizational world? And the reason I did it was because I fell in love with you guys. I am an unabashed fan of millennials and now you Z-Gens. You are the first generation that I genuinely believe are triple bottom line thinkers. You're the first generation that have been long called the most socially conscious of any prior generation, and I've lived that through my law firm, through my prior work and civic work, and I've certainly lived it for 11 years at Bentley. What I love about you is that you really do think about people and our planet before you even get to profit, regardless of what you're going into. NGOs, nonprofits, eventually the business world, you think differently. And I think you have the power, if you're given the right opportunities, like a place like Vassar does, the opportunities I was given, you have the power to change the world. No pressure, guys. But I am personally counting on you, and I've already seen what you can do in action. So the other thing that Betsy mentioned is I've been given this unusual platform to help bring change for women. And at no time prior has it felt more important to me. I felt like we were making progress at various points, but I have yet to see a tipping point in the organizational world. And I must say that what has happened this last year, as difficult as it has been, gives me hope that that's exactly where we are. The Me Too movement, the Time's Up movement, our Center for Women and Diversity in the Workplace. By the way, we're changing it. It used to be Bentley Center for Women in Business. We're changing it to Bentley Center for Women and a Diverse Workplace, a diversity in the workplace, because we now think women is too limiting. We need to open this up in expansive, smart ways, and that's what we're doing. But the whole point is to look at the wage gap, unconscious bias, and all these other persistent gender disparities and other disparities, and do something about it. So right now we're working with over 100 companies who've lined up at the door and said, we actually do want to change. So that is the classic comic book version of a 40-year career. It's been really long. I've done, some might call it peripatetic. I've done about a million different things. But to me, the thread of consistency has always been this overarching mission to do something that's about the public interest and to do something that involves my public policy interests. However, I have spent 11 years at a business university where I thought a lot about preparation while you're in school and how that delivers you into today's either graduate school, but particularly the workplace, in ways that you already have your sea legs. So regardless of where you're headed, grad school, working for a global NGO, a nonprofit, going to New York and working for a for-profit firm, or going into government and doing public policy. These are some, I'm going to give you five very quick pieces of advice that I think, some of which held true for me when I was here. I just didn't know. I couldn't have known my 19-year-old self would use these things that happened to me by accident. My goal is for it to not happen to you by accident. So my book is really about this need in an innovation economy for hybrid learning. And really, in a nutshell, it's all about having some pragmatic skill sets like computer learning and constantly upgrading your technology skills, having analytic capabilities that come through math courses and economic courses, as well as a broad-based humanities and liberal learning background that brings those critical thinking skills, communication skills, both oral and writing, and your ability to be creative creative. Don't ever lose what you're doing at Vassar. So here's what it does to colleges like Vassar. It challenges Vassar to deliver this ability to be nimble, constant, lifelong learners, and at the same time to provide opportunities for you to get some of those pragmatic skills too. That's the thesis of Prepared You. It's how you go to college, not exactly where you go to college, that matters most. So congratulations, you already picked the right place to come to college, and you have decided to get up inordinately early on a Saturday morning and start thinking for this whole weekend about what you might do with your lives post-Vassar. So here are five things about the how part. First, promise me that you'll make your major and other studies more than the sum of their parts. It's all about how you're integrating your learning. I think very often we obsess about majors, and we shouldn't. It's just unnecessary. I know virtually no employers, nonprofit, any type of employer, who dwells on majors. Most these days won't even ask you what your major is. They care more about how you explain your entire portfolio of learning. They care that you were multidisciplinary. They care that you took your major and you integrated some courses that were thematically related. And they care equally that you took some things that really forced you to stretch and have different skill sets, like taking a math course that maybe you didn't want to take, or alternatively, taking a philosophy course that you might have decided wasn't on your list. Majors should not be your singular focus. The CEO of the U.S. Olympic Committee, going into the Olympics, was a philosophy major at Dartmouth. I came close to majoring in philosophy here. Both are great for law school or anything else you might do. So let it be all about your passion. I want it. I know people say it. I mean it. Don't do anything you're not genuinely passionate about. I can't say that enough. I was so indecisive. I had no idea what I should do. I went back and forth between anthropology, sociology, political science, and I desperately wanted to be an urban studies major. I had done something like an internship that I'll mention in a second, and it was so formative for me to do this work in urban rehabilitation during the early 70s that I really thought I should be an urban studies major, only Vassar didn't yet have one. They were considering it at the time, but it hadn't been okay. So here's what happened. I hadn't declared one by fall of my senior year. I had no major. That fall, 1971, I just found this letter in that same old footlocker. The Dean of Studies, it read, "Dear Gloria, you must, I repeat, you must immediately declare a major." No student has ever graduated from Vassar College without declaring a major. So, thank goodness they didn't send that letter to my parents, and I believe I declared sociology as my major that very day. Had I had the option, it would have been urban studies, but I learned a lot later that it just didn't matter. Had I picked philosophy, had I picked political science, that would have been great for everything else I did. Yes, so again, focus on your passion, be able to talk about it and deliver a narrative for grad school or for an employer that really explains, again, how you integrated your learning and thematically how it relates. It should be bespoke. It should be all about personal to you, permutation and combination for you, deep and broad knowledge within and across disciplines. I know you think about this at Vassar. And I have to encourage my kids at Bentley. They need to understand it's not about being a finance and eco-fi major. It's about being a sustainability science major, which we have, and coupling that with eco-fi. And blending these things together and then being able to explain why. So let me give you one quick example. Combining Vassar's environmental studies major with a correlated minor in sustainability, coupled with courses in economics and public policy, would set you up extremely well for grad school, environmental policy work in the public arena, a position with a wind farm startup, or as an analyst for an investment firm constructing socially responsible portfolios. The bottom line is figure out what's good for you, what you love, and then be really clear about how it fits as you leave school with things that you want to do in the future. Second, promise me you will take every opportunity you can to practice what you're learning in the classroom. I think 70% of you at least do an internship, at least one internship while you're here. Hallelujah. But team assignments in class, service learning in the community, which I would believe all of you are doing to one degree or another, research projects with professors, incredibly invaluable. All test drive your passion for a particular area, expands your perspective, it shows what you're capable of doing in terms of learning. Wall Street Journal calls internships the new first job. That's become common wisdom today. Everybody gets it. It's true. But there are other ways to get it if you don't end up doing an internship. A national survey conducted by Gallup and Purdue found that experiential learning is vital to both your left brain selves, logical, technical, analytical skills, and your right brain creativity, intuitive, and artistic capabilities. These benefits are magnified for those who do an internship or work at least one semester with a professor on a long-term school project. Third, I know you're going to get this when you already do. The relationships you form in college can be life-changing. It's all about gaining personal confidence, but it's also about growing as a person. It's where you find empathy. It's where you express diverse opinions. It's all about really figuring out, again, this essence of who you are and what you want to do. Having a mentor in college who encourages you to pursue your goals and dreams, again, Gallup Purdue found this is so important. So is having a professor, thank goodness for our faculty at a place like Faculty, who genuinely show they care about you. They understand you as a person. I had that at Vassar. Professor Leslie Kimple was chairman of the sociology department, and throughout my 4 years, she advised me on things that were happening outside the college campus in terms of activism, but she also advised me on my studies, and a couple of years later, she served as a reference for law school for me. She was both a mentor and an advisor, and I'm grateful every time I think about that. Gallup also found out, though, that what you do with each other is just as important as the relationships you have with mentors and your faculty. Mentors. So the more you interact, I mean, you guys are all incredibly smart and you all care about changing the world. What you do and learn from one another is as important as anything else you're going to learn on this campus. The friendships and connections will last forever. Look at the mentors who are here. Many of them are here because they've shared this experience before with one another and they're excited. I mean, this is a mini reunion for the mentors in addition to being here to talk to you guys. But it's going to hold you in good stead long after you've left Poughkeepsie. Fourth, again, most of you are probably doing this. I can't urge you enough to get actively involved outside the classroom, both in terms of campus activities, but also in terms of things you can do in the community, both here and your home communities. It helps you so much when you're active on campus and in the community to learn about resilience, empathy, teamwork, to express your values. So these things are incredibly important. And once again, Gallup tells us from the data that if you're an RA, if you join student government, if you lead an affinity group, if you are teaching kids in a local school, these are things that make a much higher level, bring a much higher level of happiness and contentedness and well-being post-college. And another thing that I'm not sure I have to tell kids at Vassar, sometimes I do tell the kids at Bentley to do this, promise me while you're here, this is a safe space, take risks. Be in a college forum where everybody sounds like their opinions are the same and you happen to have a diverse opinion, say it. Say it out loud. It couldn't be more important. Take a course. Math intimidated me. I made myself take a math course. I wish I'd taken 5 math courses while I was at Vassar. Well, maybe not 5. But you know, take on a leadership role or just form a group. You don't have to be the leader. Everyone can be the leader in the group. But the confidence that you build and taking risks is something that will hold you in good stead for a very long time, if not forever. This is something I have had to convince myself to do over and over again. I've had to summon the courage to jump in the deep into the pool and not hold on to the side every time I made a major change. I'm just going to give you one very quick example. 20 years ago, Governor Bill Weld called me into his office and he said, the Secretary of Economic Affairs is leaving his post. There's only been one other woman in this job. Do you know anyone who's qualified? It was, at the time, my dream job. I spent 20 minutes advocating for 5 other people and never once mentioned myself. It was a huge gaffe. He stopped me. He was a very impatient guy. I can't believe he let me go on for 20 minutes. He's a hugely impatient guy. He stopped me and he said, Gloria, I called you in here because I thought you were the pitch perfect candidate for the job. Now I'm virtually positive you're not. You didn't earn the job. And I had to stop myself. I dug a hole, 8,000 feet deep, and regroup, horrified as I was, and cast the role, with my own, making my own case. I promised myself I would never do that again. Take risks, be open in, you know, a diplomatic way about what you're good at. Don't ever shy away from explaining why your light shines brightly in a particular circumstance. So, when I was approached about the unthinkable, about becoming president of Bentley College, I summoned the courage and said, yeah, let me at least talk with you about it. And you know, a year-long conversation, that's how we recruit college presidents, resulted in being actually offered the job. And as I alluded to earlier, nothing has ever been nearly so rewarding as being with these amazing millennials, our faculty, our staff, and watching these kids go out into these adults, these young adults go out into the world and make a difference. It's a Bentley universe, it's a business school, so you won't be surprised that I'm on LinkedIn with about 8,000 of my former graduates. They all ask me to join them on LinkedIn when they leave. Instead, I'm hopeful, if you're not into LinkedIn, that you'll just email me or text me if you ever need anything. I would hope you would, because I would always be available. So, that's it. The last thing I want to say is what I started with. I've purposely avoided saying anything about making a career and life plan. You might have figured out by now that I just don't believe in that. Experience has taught me personally that doing what you're passionate about, what makes you happy, and using that as your guide at Vassar, grad school maybe afterwards, certainly your first job and every job after that, will make a huge difference in how you feel about yourself and about life. The other aspect that I just want to, final words to urge you to do, is be open to the unexpected curves. You know, a lot of times you think that jobs come in sort of sequential order, and the best thing you can possibly do is make your career a lattice or a jungle gym. Think of it as a jungle gym. It might be really fun to go here, and it opens new opportunities for you, things that you would never have thought about. I would never have thought about almost any of the things that I did because they weren't sequential. And as lateral moves happen, it actually sometimes takes you in ways that are more empowering to you personally and where you're making a bigger difference. So it's obviously been the story of my career. It's a very non-traditional story, but I like to think it's a classic Vassar story because we're open to the non-traditional and being different, and I just know you'll keep an open mind. Yeah, you're gonna have a lot of knowledge and you're gonna develop a lot of skill sets. You're gonna have to update them continuously over time. More requirements, more responsibilities in the workplace, whatever you're doing, but taking chances are just as important. I have had more twists, turns, and zigzags over the last 40 years than I could ever possibly imagine, and every single one of them has been an aha moment to me, opening my eyes to something new and being more gratifying than the last thing that I did. So that's what I want for you guys. I want you to have a rewarding career. Mostly, though, I want you to have really happy, productive lives where you're giving in communities, where wherever you live and work, which I know you will. I know you're gonna treasure your experience here. The fact is, as Vassar grads, I think you already have a leg up on every single thing that I've said, but at the same time, I really mean it when I tell you that coming back here has been yet another one of those aha moments for me. It's so encouraging to look out at the faces of a new generation that are going to help us address U.S. and global messes that we may be in currently. And I just think you're going to help us speed up the reel, and anything I can do to be helpful in your quest, please give me a call. And by the way, at Bentley, the kids all call me Gloria, and I sure hope you will here too. So thank you so much for letting me come to Vassar. I love you guys. You're amazing. I'm looking at my boss. I wanted to do Q&A, but I think
we might be a little bit good for time.
Okay. So if you want to and you have a moment to sprint up here, I've been everything you could ever imagine by the media many times over. So feel free to just come up and say hi or ask me anything that's a burning question. I'd love to meet you all.
So that was
an amazingly inspirational story from Nancy Drew to college president. And I love so much that you said that that was a classic Vassar tale. I hear that so often, and you'll hear it today too from the mentors, connecting those seemingly disparate dots to put it all together, being open and ready for whatever opportunities may come your way is definitely a theme of this weekend and life. So without further ado, we want to begin making our way over to Rocky because those industry clusters will start promptly at 10 o'clock. And I want to thank you again, Gloria, for providing such a great open to our program.